Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Alice Sampson, Assistant Professor with the Nalsa University of Law. This paper is African and Caribbean Prose and Poetry. And in this module, we will be looking at Edward Kumau Brathwaite's poems. Before we begin, let me give you an overview of the module. Edward Kumau Brathwaite is one of the most renowned of English writers to have emerged from the Caribbean islands. This lesson introduces students to the life and work of Brathwaite through mother poem, sections of the Arrivants and Middle Passages. Students will be exposed to the life and works of the poet, the themes that he has explored in his poems, and the unique style which he has adopted. Introductions to the poem. Brathwaite has authored several collections of poems, essays, and plays. Some of his prominent publications include Four Plays for Primary Schools, published in 1964, Odell's Choice, 1967, Rites of Passage, 1967, Masks, 1968, Islands, 1969, Folk Culture of the Slaves in Jamaica, 1970, The Development of Creole Society in Jamaica, 1770 to 1820, published in 1971, The Arrivants, 1973, Contradictory Omens, Cultural Diversity and Integration in the Caribbean, 1974, Other Exiles, 1975, Days and Nights, 1975, Barbados Poetry, 79, Sun Poems, 82, Afternoon of the Status Quo, 82, Gods of the Middle Passages, 82, and Third World Poems, 1983. In this module, we will discuss the poems included in the Arrivants, Mother Poem, and Middle Passages. The Arrivants is a trilogy, consists of three volumes of poems, including The Rites of Passage, Masks, and Islands. In the poem Tom, which is included in the volume Rites of Passage, Brathwaite writes, "So many seeds the cotton breeds, so many seeds our fathers need." The beginning of the poem points out that for the emancipated population which is employed on the plantation, life is very difficult. The family structure is emasculated and children are removed from their parents. The social milieu in an otherwise fertile soil is unnecessarily harsh. The colonial master requires more hands to exploit the lands which have been assigned to him. Hence, they require more men. Brathwaite says, "Grow on, cotton lands, go on to the bottom, lands where the quick cassava grows, where the sick back dries, where no one knows if he lives or dies." Brathwaite paints the harsh reality of life in the islands. Centuries of exploitation have led to a situation where life and death exist as mere words devoid of their meaning. In the other poems, "Didn't He Ramble," Brathwaite writes, "So to New York, London, I finally come, hope in my belly, hate smothered down to the bone to suit the part I'm playing." In the poems, in the Arrivants, shed light on the situation that have forced the folk from the islands to find their way to the metropolis. The poems also depict the plight that these immigrants face as they build their lives in unfamiliar and harsh milieu. The theme of nothing keeps recurring through the book. The Arrivants deals with the idea of Africa as an imaginary homeland to which the Caribbean black population is forced to cling to. However, Brathwaite doesn't romanticize Africa. Instead, he uses Africa as the backdrop to explore and contest the ideas of the Caribbean population and the fact that they have not achieved much. He says, "For we have not achieved nothing. Work, who have not built dream, who have forgotten all. Dance and dare to remember." The mother poem is one of the best works of Brathwaite. The poem deems his island and his mother. Divided into four sections, Rock, Seed, Night Wash, Took, and Comfort. The collection describes the poet's engagement with his island. He points out that his mother, the island nation of Barbados, is the most English nation in the West Indies. The first section deals with the social history of the island. The second and the third sections deal with the troubles that the island faces as it seeks to accommodate its diverse history. And in the final section, Brathwaite, the poet, argues that the impending end of the exploitation offers the mother to rejuvenate herself. The Middle Passages is a volume of selected poems which deal with the image of Africa, Caribbean, and the nature of change. 6 of the 14 poems included in the Middle Passages are taken from 10 Bar Self, published in 1987. 10 Bar Self is the last book of Brathwaite's Bhajan trilogy. In 10 Bar Self, Brathwaite traced the complex genealogy of African diaspora. It takes into account the multifaceted histories of slavery. As the slaves are captured, bound and brought from Africa to the Caribbean islands and the Americas, they collectively face experiences of violence and humiliation. The slaves have lost their histories, culture and voices or languages. The poem deals with the trauma of the loss of inheritance, where the only constant in the lives of the displaced population is these reminders and an uncertain future. Middle Passages is a historical reality with many of the contemporary African writers, including V.S. Naipaul, have dealt with. Introduction to the poet. Gordon Roller has argued that all the Caribbean writers, Edward Kamau Brathwaite and George Lamming, are unique as they exist as nationalists, regionalists and internationalists at the same time. The American poet and literary critic Hayden Carruth declared that Brathwaite is a poet of real accomplishment of any standards, to whom we must not only give our attention but also our admiration. Born Lawson Edward Brathwaite in the city of Barbados, Brathwaite began his secondary education in 1945. He attended the Harrison College and won a scholarship to attend Cambridge University. In England, he majored in English and history. He passed out of Cambridge in 1953 with a BA in history and began to work on the Caribbean Voices program with the British Broadcasting Corporation. He completed his diploma of education from Cambridge and found a job as an education officer on the Gold Coast, Ghana, in Africa. This stint at the Ministry of Education, Ghana, proved to be a turning point in his life. During his 5-year stay in Africa, Brathwaite strove to discover the cultures of Africa. In 1960, he took a year's leave and returned to England. In England, he met and married Doris Monica, who hailed from Guyana. In Ghana, Brathwaite began to write prolifically. His first publication from Africa was the play Odile's Choice, which was premiered in Ghana at Fansiman Secondary School. In 1962-63, Brathwaite moved to the island nation of St. Lucia, where he worked as the resident tutor in the Department of Extramural Studies. Later in 1963, he was appointed as a teacher of history at Kingston campus of the University of West Indies. In Jamaica, Brathwaite co-founded the Caribbean Artistic Movement and in 1970 launched Savako, a literary journal. In 1971, Brathwaite accepted a City of Nairobi Fellowship. In Kenya, he came into close contact with Ngugi Wathiango. Ngugi conferred Brathwaite the title Kamau. In 1992, he was offered the position of a professor at New York University. He has been teaching comparative literature in New York ever since, and he's a colleague of Ngugi there. Brathwaite also spent 3 self-financed years, which he termed the Maroon Years, from 1997 to 2000 in Barbados. He married Beverly Reed, a Jamaican, and in 2002, the University of Sussex conferred an honorary doctorate on Kamau Brathwaite. He is known for his strong political views when compared to his peers, including V.S. Naipaul and Derek Walcott. Brathwaite's writing is overtly political. At various stages of his career, Brathwaite has been involved in the creation of ideologies such as negritude, pan-Africanism and regionalism. Through his poems, he pays homage to the victims of slavery. Slavery was deeply involved with violence, and most of Brathwaite's poems are written in the Caribbean Creole and explicitly challenge the linear, exclusive colonial historiography which is created in the metropolis. The poems inquire how the gods are born, how histories are made and how they are told. The poems, even as they dissect the violence that the emaciated populations were exposed to, are beautifully structured. As a poet, historian, critic, cultural activist and teacher, he has posited that the Caribbean is a crucible of various interweaved traditions and has produced its own cultural forms that not only speak with an indigenous Creole voice, but have the capability of posing an alternative model to the Western tradition. Rathwaite has written several celebrated works on literary criticism. His works contextualize the writing emerging from the post-colonial world, and some of them include Folk Culture of the Slaves in Jamaica, History of the Voice, Development of Nation Language in Anglophone Caribbean Poetry, among others. Often Rathwaite is unfavorably compared to his peers V.S. Naipaul and Derek Walcott, both of whom received the Nobel Prize for Literature. Outside African and the Caribbean region, he's quite not popular, unlike his illustrious contemporaries like George Lamming. Eileen Savory, in her still unpublished piece, Returning of Psychorax, Prospero's Response, Edward Kumau Brathwaite's Word Journey, examined the history of Brathwaite's publications in the West and highlighted the fact that the Western literary market was reticent in publishing several texts by Brathwaite. She says that the publishers often did not reveal the causes as to why they were not publishing the works. Savory further adds that it was Brathwaite's defiance of the continued dominance of discourse deriving from Western intellectual history and his reluctance to discuss the so-called third world or minority cultural products within Western referential signposts that led to him being censored by both the readers and the publishers of the northern metropolises. Thus, Brathwaite's apparent inability to penetrate the Western literary scene is actually due to his political leanings. His career is a testimony to the fact that despite the several gains made by the postcolonial subjects, the global order is such that writers from the third world also need to seek authenticity and value historicity. They find it difficult to gain acceptance in the first world. It is not to suggest that Brathwaite has a dearth of admirers. The language and the themes that he uses to describe the human condition and his insistence on privileging the African have made Brathwaite popular across the postcolonial world. Themes in Mother Poem. The Mother Poem, 1977, is perhaps the most noted of Brathwaite's works. It is considered a part of the trilogy alongside Sun Poem, 1982, Ten Bar Self, 87. In the Mother Poem, Brathwaite takes a broader view and focuses on the mix of voices in the Caribbean region. Unlike in The Arrivance, Brathwaite does not focus on the growth or lack of growth of an individual consciousness alone. He considers the nature of sex, race and geography on the growth and development of thought in Caribbean. He points out the limitations of these themes that have limited the growth of both the Caribbean or nationalist consciousness on the islands. The Mother Poem is indicative of the fact that Brathwaite is a nationalist and the interests of the Barbados are of utmost priority to him. As he writes in the preface to the poem, the mother in the poem is the nation of Barbados. He points out that the island nation is porous and weak and reminds the reader that Barbados is a small island which is full of limestone formations and dried up water sources. A landscape which is severely fragmented is further, as Brathwaite points out, debilitated by the experience of colonialism. The poem is divided into four sections: rock seed, night wash, toque and comfort. In the poem, Brathwaite highlights the experience of a woman in revival church as she is possessed by the Haitian god of the sweet waters and Dambala, the snake. Brathwaite resorts to the bajan, the subculture of Jamaican and Barbados, which is supposed to be coarse and lewd, uses the drum, the beat and the body to base the poem in what he terms alternative folk or oral traditions. Common everyday things find place in the poems as Brathwaite contradicts the notion that the poet is a noble rider in the mundane world. He summons young Caliban howling for his tongue, places him along with the computer conjure man, children eating dirt, and the much ignored mother of Caliban, black Psychorax, are situated alongside. The Psychorax is treated with respect. What a way them is make, we burn in we blackness. What a way them is trouble me see. She don't feed the dog, though she han in eye black, say that favor a nigger. This is a quotation from Dye's Mother Poem. Thus, the work contextualizes the hybridity of Barbados, an island which was inhabited by humans before the advent of Christianity, modernity, colonialism, and slave trade began. The poem depicts the subjugation, coercion, and rape of the mother, that is the island, the nature of the emaciated and emasculated sons, and urges for a cultural awakening to save the mother from further exploitation and eventual destruction. some of the themes in the Arrivance. To fully appreciate the Arrivance, we need to keep in mind the life of Braithwaite as we read the poems. Braithwaite rather convincingly argued that the Middle Passage's experience was not an entirely traumatic experience. He viewed the Middle Passage as an experience which allowed a pathway or a channel between African traditions and what is being evolved on the new soil in the Caribbean. In the essay, Time Hri, Braithwaite states that he went to England believing that he was a British citizen. However, in the mother country, he found and felt rootless. On completion of his education, Braithwaite went on exile to Ghana. In Ghana, he discovered his African roots. Slowly, slowly, ever so slowly, obscurely, slowly, but surely, during the 8 years that I lived there, I was coming to an awareness and understanding of community, of cultural wholeness, of the place of the individual within the tribe in society. He gradually began to develop a sense of identification as he associated with the people of Ghana whom he deemed were his living diviners. In Ghana, he came to connect his history with theirs. This association for him was the bridge of mind now linking Atlantic and the ancestor, homeland and heartland. Literary historian Bruce King argued that in Africa, Braithwaite found a culture in which there is a profound relationship of individual and of the spiritual world to the community. Before Braithwaite attempted to write The Arrivance, he was interested in Afrocentricity. As Paul Gilroy discussed, Braithwaite's belief in Afrocentricity helped him to create, recreate, and reconstruct African genius and values and narrate his experiences. These values for Braithwaite are to be created from experience and history. Thus, Africa is the central theme of his poems. The section titled Masks, Braithwaite refers to several of Africa's cultural markers. These include African empires such as Ghana, Mali, Congo and Chad. He writes about the urban centers of Axum, Timbuktu and others. The legends and the myths of Africa are reinforced along the history of African American personalities like Chaka, Osei Tutu and African gods like Ogun Dambala. The poems also evoke the tropical African rainforests and lists out the flora and fauna of Africa. Masks is very different from the violated new world where Braithwaite inhabits. Braithwaite's vision of Africa is mythical and nostalgic, and it paints a picture of the same. It seems Braithwaite is the sun returning to his roots. These poems could have been titled Africa, however, Braithwaite terms them masks. The choice of the title is political, his efforts are not to romanticize the pasts. In the poem, black population are denied home, culture, language and religion. They are prevented from forming self and are subjected to dehumanizing experiences. Yet the black man in the new world has survived and made the world his home. The poet argues that before the black man can possess it fully, he must understand that journey which he was forced to undertake from Africa to the new world. This is the theme in Masks. Africa, Braithwaite argues, welcomes its children who are returning home. He says, well have you walked, have you journeyed, welcome, you who have come back a stranger after 300 years, welcome, here is a stool for you, sit, do you remember? Thus, Braithwaite argues that the poem of a personal journey to Africa induces a catharsis only if the subject understood the meaning of return. In other words, the black men of the New World would find the voyage to Africa meaningful only if they are aware of Africa's ruined cities, lost empires, lost babies, and necessary sacrifices. The subject has to comprehend and appreciate that Africa bears her share of the burden. She has to respect and help renew the remembrance and performance of ancient rituals. Themes in Middle Passages. Braithwaite's spouse, Doris Monica Braithwaite, in a descriptive and chronological bibliography of the works of Edward Kumar Braithwaite, mentioned that V.S. Naipaul's vision for the Caribbean was laid out in his Middle Passages, was bare and insensitive with little hope or promise. Monica claims that she was a witness of the Middle Passages and states that Braithwaite's vision is so clearly forced into the kind of utterance which comes out not only from his experience but also arises from the deep concern with the future of Caribbean literature. Psychorak's video style is probably the best known and the most interesting poem in the collection. Braithwaite was in many ways the precursor to the contemporary practitioner of digital humanities. His use of computers to write poetry, not merely type on it, is a manifestation of the fact that he realized that the new scientific contrivance would aid his poetic expression. Letter Sycorax, an epistolary text appearing middle passages, provides the intellectual framework that informs the style Brathwaite has ventured to rehearse in this new literary phase. The computers enable Brathwaite to experiment with the form of the poem, and these experiments help to create a new style. This new aesthetic allowed him to explore and address diverse themes. The computer, unlike the typewriter, provided him greater movement in his poems, including variations in font size and appearance of the letters, bold, capital, italic forms, a streamlined punctuation where periods replace the commas but also fall in the middle of works. The words are interrupted into various syllables, and these interruptions disrupt their usual meaning. Brathwaite plays with the alignment of the poem. These transformations in the form allowed him to use the nation language more efficiently. The use of the nation language is best illustrated in Letter Sycorax. The narrator uses nation language and explores the new possibilities of writing on a computer. The poet redraws every X in the poem, hence every X is big and bold and stands out with an added flair. The words are realigned to point out the inherent irony of colonialism. The Caliban is attempting to avoid the examples of the Prospero. The text is aligned to the right, several words are intentionally misspelled, and he uses non-English words. The poem is addressed to the mother Sycorax, mother of Caliban, whom Shakespeare and other European writers have depicted as an exiled, evil witch who exercised demonic control over several spirits. The poet informs his mother, "Dear Mama, the computer has opened up endless possibilities for writing and is one the best things since Cicero." The innovation in computer enables a writer to re-examine and comment on the relationship between Prospero and Caliban. The poet declines to limit himself to merely opposing Prospero, but chooses a more self-assertive outlook on history and self. He says, "But is like what I try into sense and say and see about muse in computer and mouse to learn in Prospero lingo and thing not fadem, not fadem, the way Caliban done, but fevi, fevi." The combination of Letter Sycorax and the more linear texts that make up passages puts us in touch with Brathwaite's sustained efforts at articulating and realigning his personal feelings with that of his community, of reconciling literary and oral traditions in Caribbean poetry. The poems are also indicative of his transition and his assessment of contemporary post-colonialism. In the other poem, X Bar Self, Brathwaite is the X Bar Self who has become the Caliban. The Caliban is informing his much maligned mother of his new place in history. He is offering his mother the perspective of history. The poem begins with, "Dear Mama, writing you this letter, why? Guess what? Pun a computer, okay?" While many critics have pointed out that Caliban is exhilarated that he has found a computer, new toy, Caliban is only excited at discovering a new mode of communication which allows and shows him to reach out to his mother. He further develops Sycorax's video style. In Letter Sycorax, Brathwaite argues that Sycorax was the rightful owner, possessed the island where she gave birth to her Caliban. She was falsely implicated, imprisoned and indentured in Prospero. As Caliban is strong enough to work for Prospero, Sycorax is imprisoned and banished, and then she might become submerged as not to let her appear. Brathwaite privileged Sycorax and believes that the key to actual political emancipation of the Caribbean world lies in it discovering its cultural authenticity. Like the Sycorax which was submerged, the culture of the Caribbean population is buried under the experience of colonization. The Caribbean population is the Caliban. The culture of the Caribbean people is the Sycorax. To psychologically liberate Caliban, the cultural revival of Sycorax is a precondition. Hence, the mother has to return and the Caliban has to drink his mother's milk. Brathwaite equates milk with language, which is speak his own mother's language. Caliban's exposure to the schools, mass media and other such alien institutions established by Prospero has led to his alienation. To undo his alienation, Caliban has to rediscover his self. The colonized Caliban must, besides revolting against Prospero's imposition, also discover his own roots. The Caliban must seek the Sycorax. the carrier, the keeper, the protector of the native cultures, whose banishment, with all its disadvantages, has nonetheless enabled her to preserve in a submerged manner the very essence of the native culture and to hold on to the secrets of the possibly alternative culture for the Caribbean. We have now examined Kamau Brathwaite's poems in some detail. We have looked at some of the major themes and even read out small bits of his poems. To refer to more details, please look at the e-text. Thank you.